Hey, Guest Services, it's great to see you guys. I'm so excited that we're back into the church. Hey, the reason for this video, we're going to talk about Chapter 9 of The Comeback Effect, which is titled Choose Values Over Policies. And in this video, we're going to find out what that means. The chapter opens up talking about Daniel. Daniel is a parking volunteer and he serves in the preschool parking lot. As people pull in the parking lot, they see Daniel in a lime green vest holding two lightsabers, one in each hand, aka orange light wands. He dances around and guides people to their parking spot, and he brings joy to them. He brings a smile to their face. The kids look forward to seeing Daniel every single week. You see, Daniel takes potentially aggravated parents, aggravated due to the stress of a parking lot or arguing in the back of the minivan on the way to church, and he turns it into a positive experience. Daniel made the decision to let his personality shine through to create an amazing experience for guests and regular attendees. So why is Daniel doing this? Is he doing this because it's one of the church's policies? Daniel is living out one of the church's values, which is the value of having fun. Honestly, if the church created a policy that said all parking lot volunteers must dance around and pretend like they have two lightsabers, it would be awkward. For many, it would seem uncomfortable or mechanical. But in Daniel's situation, the having fun value allowed him to highlight his unique personality. Obviously, everybody has different personalities. So for one person, it might be juggling, while another person might be telling a joke when appropriate. For another person, it may be just smiling because they truly enjoy their role. Organizations typically create policies that they govern by. Yes, most organizations have values, but do they live by their values? When you're in a policy-driven organization, policies are needed for just about every single scenario, which is impossible. The power in value-driven ministry or organizations is that it makes decisions easy for volunteers or staff members. When a situation or question arises, team members don't have to scroll through their heads of different policies that they've learned throughout the year. They can simply reflect back to the organization's values to see if it aligns or not. This is good stuff. Think of it like this. When a new technology arises, governments have to determine whether they're going to create new laws to regulate the use of the technology. Consider cell phones in cars. Several years ago, new laws were introduced that prohibited the use of cell phones while driving. When we're in a policy world, we have to keep making new policies to keep up with everything.
Don't reroute your GPS when your car is in motion.
No virtual reality headsets while driving.
Don't put on makeup while the car's in motion. Do not text people while driving.
The list of laws would become so long, it would be ridiculous because situations keep changing. But if we were a value-based nation, we could say, as a nation, we value distraction-free driving. Don't drive distracted. That covers just about everything. Now, for governments, creating values typically don't work, so they have to create laws. But we're not a government, we're a church. So why should we have values in our ministry or organization? Values last. They're not created on a whim of a new trend. Values keep you from having a list of constrictive rules. They provide freedom for individuality. Values help keep things consistent across the organization. Let me ask you a couple questions. Do you have a list of values for yourself or your family? Does Faith Promise have values? Does the Guest Services Ministry have values? Faith Promise actually does have values. Faith Promise's values are: we put God first, we serve others, we give generously, we grow together, we tell Him of them, and we elevate those around us. Most organizations have values, but if they don't permeate everything that you do, they're simply nice statements. Did you know our values? Did you know Faith Promise had those values? Did you know what they were? If not, don't feel guilty. Actually, it's probably my fault for not teaching them to you on a consistent basis. Everything we do as a church should revolve around those six values. Let's play a game. Guess, if you're watching this video, I want you to play along too. It's really fun and easy. So here's what I want you to do. I'm gonna tell you about Sandra. Sandra's a greeter at her church. The church she belongs to has a set of four values. As I tell you this story, I want you to try to identify which values she was living out. But before we get started, I gotta tell you what those values are. Her church's values are show care, have fun, remain flexible, and deliver wow. Again, show care, have fun, remain flexible, and deliver wow. All right, here we go. All right, so Sandra's greeting. She's standing by her door at her usual spot, but she notices not many people are walking past her. So she moved. She moved to a spot that would have a bigger impact on the people that she greeted. The book actually said she moved several times within 1 hour, all within 150 feet from where she originally started. So why did she move? She paid attention to where the people were going and identified the best possible place for her to stand to help the guest feel the benefit. She wasn't focused on being in the same spot every week. Her approach was, I'll go where I'm needed, and while there, I'll be flexible to respond to people, flow, and their needs. She didn't make it about herself. She made it about the guest. All right, so what values was Sandra living out? If you're not sure, that's okay. You can rewind the video and listen again if you want. Personally, I think she was living out several of the values. I think she was showing care. I think she was showing care by making it about the guest and not herself. She could have had the attitude of, this is my spot and people are used to me being here. I also believe she was living out the value of remain flexible. Again, she didn't decide on one spot and remain there. She remained flexible by moving to the spot that would have the biggest impact. The last value I think she was touching on, and this is controversial, but was delivering wow. But how do you deliver wow? Well, I think that depends who is in front of you. It's gonna be different for every single person. If she remained in one spot and wasn't flexible, she couldn't have set herself up to deliver wow. But because she was making it about the guest, she put herself in a position to deliver wow. Let me be clear. I don't think Sandra delivered wow. I think Sandra set herself up so it's possible she could deliver wow. I want to go back to a question I asked you earlier. Do you have a list of values to live by? If you work for a company, chances are they have a list of values. But what about you? Do you have personal values that you live by? Honestly, we can all say that we have values, right? But have you ever sat down and made a list of values to live your life by? The book goes into great detail on how to come up with a list of values. We may, as a group, come up with our own guest services values, but not right now. So once we have values, how do you take that list and create an active, breathing list of values that affects everything you do? One, we live them. This actually starts with the leaders. If one of our values is to have fun, the leaders need to set the tone for that. If I was stressed out all the time, walked around in a negative mood and had a bad attitude, do you think that would rub off on some people? Or do you think I would set the tone for having fun? It would be almost impossible for everybody to have fun. Two, teach it. Great leaders teach their values to their team and teach it often. Whether you're a leader in a church or your organization or not, teach the values to others. Studies show that it takes teaching something at least 3 times before it actually sticks. So present the values in different ways each time you teach them. Number three, acknowledge them when you see them in your team members. Again, whether you're a leader, a manager, an executive, or a part-time employee, acknowledge the positive. People place value on the things you praise. Think of it this way. If a parent raises a young daughter, always telling her how beautiful she is, that child will grow up believing that beauty is of the utmost importance. She'll believe that beauty is the way that she can make people happy with her, and her life will center on beauty. But what about if a parent praises things like integrity, honesty? Those things would become the focus of her life instead, even into adulthood. And while we may not have that big of an impact on each other, your praise will ultimately determine what the people around you value, even if you're not the leader. So, we're gonna add something new to our weekly meetings. Yay! Every week, we're gonna set aside a couple of minutes so people can praise each other. When you see something that upholds one of our values or delivers wow, call it out at one of our meetings. We're gonna call it pause for applause. We pause for applause. Number four, identify creative and memorable ways to communicate to your team. One of the things that Jesus did to make his teaching so memorable was telling stories. He even made them shocking at times, making the assumed villain become the hero of the story, as in the Good Samaritan. There's something about stories and the unexpected that stick in our minds. Use stories to make our values memorable for each other. Number five, invite people onto the team that already live out the values. We all know people who aren't serving, and we want our teams to grow, right? And we're always asking you to tap on shoulders, meaning to recruit volunteers. But Guest Services is a unique team. We don't want just anybody. We want people that can deliver wow. People with great people skills. People that live out the values. Number six, create ways for team members to participate in a value. The book teaches to empower team members to support the value. It talks about giving team members tools so they can support the values. At Buckhead Church, the church in the book, they created kid packs, which are little packs that have crayons, coloring books, and goldfish crackers. The goal of these packs is when a parent brings a child out of the sanctuary because they were unruly, a guest service team member gives them a kid pack. That is delivering wow. You're giving the parent something for their child to distract them from what is going on. And it's helped taking that negative emotion, remember we talked about this in an earlier chapter, it's helped taking that negative emotion off of that parent so they're not embarrassed for having to bring their child out of that sanctuary. But we know that happens every week. Buckhead Church took the extra step to have a plan in place for when bad things happen. Number seven, talk about times when values don't go well. We all know that things happen, right? Instead of getting upset, use them as learning experiences. When I look back at my life, I have made a ton of mistakes. They helped me to grow, and they have taught me important lessons to make me a better person. Let's do the same thing when we mess up. We know things are gonna happen, so let's turn them into learning experiences. Number eight, attach behaviors to each value. Get out your list of values and write supporting behaviors for each one. For example, if one of our values was to deliver wow, supporting behaviors could include doing the small things really well, make personal connections with people, create surprise and delight moments, and think through nonverbal gestures. Number nine, give and receive feedback through the filter of values. Again, I don't mean to sound like a pessimist, but things will go wrong. When something goes wrong, tie the error back to the value. What happened today wasn't a good example of delivering wow. Number 10, give team members incremental steps on aligning the values. Change is hard and it can take time. Never criticize someone that misaligns on one of our values. Instead, use encouragement. Make the fault seem easy to correct. When you provide simple, tangible steps for improvement, it gives them something to aim for. Nobody wants to feel like a situation is helpless. One of the things I like to do is you hear the phrase constructive criticism. I don't like that phrase. Let's instead use the words constructive feedback. It just sounds better and it feels better. Nobody wants to be criticized, but most people don't mind receiving feedback. Wow, I know that was a lot of information. When we first started this series, I gave everybody a 3 to 5 minute time limit on the video. That went out the window during the first video. Sorry. This book is rich with great material that you can use in your church, your organization, your business, or in your personal life. In my opinion, this book boils down to the golden rule. Do unto others as you would have them do to you, or treat people like they want to be treated. I wonder where that rule came from. Anyways, thank you for all that you do. I am so proud of this team, and we cannot do it without you. I know I say that a lot, but it is absolutely true. We cannot do this without you. I love you guys. Stay safe, and I'll see you soon.